morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Today is the second Sunday in the season of Lent. I welcome you to worship with the charming member of the church. And Pastor Mary Ivana, I'm happy to worship with you today, whether you're gathered here in our sanctuary or joining us online. We welcome all, and we invite you, especially those who are joining online, to let us know if you're worshiping with us this morning. In the comments or a heart or praying hand, it's always helpful to know that we're worshiping together. So, today we'll celebrate communion, which is a sign of God's grace for all of us. And we trust in God's grace to be with us wherever we are. So whether you're here in the sanctuary or joining us online, know that God's grace is meeting all of us. During Lent, we're focusing on living out our baptismal calling. Baptism is a part of our faith journey, one step in a lifelong, spirit-led process meant to guide us every day. Last week, we focused on the reality of temptation in our lives and found some consolation in the story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. Today, we'll join Nicodemus in his late-night meeting with Jesus as he asks questions about what it means to be born again. Now, maybe that language is comfortable for you, or maybe not, but it's worth looking at what it means for our lives. So we'll be invited to touch the water as a reminder of God's grace in our lives and our baptism, and we'll come to the table of grace this morning as we celebrate communion together. But to enter into worship this morning, I would invite you to join me in the centering song. We'll sing one verse of Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew, that I may love yourself, God's love, and do what thou wouldst do.
Gathered together, we pray for peace in our lives and in the lives of so many who are around us and in peace for our world. We claim the power of God's peace revealed in Jesus, and so I invite you to join this morning as we bring peace. The peace of Christ be with you. And take a moment where you are to turn around for those near you to offer a sign of peace this morning, a wave or a heart for those of you joining online. We share the peace of Christ with you as well. And I want to invite those who are gathered here to stand as you're able as we share our statement of faith. It means a lot when we share, agreed together a statement of faith about what we believe, and so this is a powerful one. And I invite you to join in that together as God leads us.
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and created, who has come in Jesus, the Word makes flesh, to the right of the Lamb and the King, who works for us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are all to meet Christ, to celebrate God's justice, to love and serve others, to seek justice and to seek love, to proclaim Jesus.
To God be the glory, great things He hath done, so mighty the world that He gave us His Son, who yielded His life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear Him.
Remain standing as we pray the prayer of the day. And from that prayer, we'll go right in to our Lord and Father today.
Holy Spirit, you just go right to the room. You are seeing a little bit of us. Your presence come to our hearts.
We may be renewed and reborn.
Open our minds.
And we may perceive your kingdom.
Lift up our eyes toward the cross of Christ's faith for our peace.
So may we believe, and in believing that eternal life, through Him who, in your love for us, you sent into the world, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
And invite those who are young and young at heart to close the attention this morning, and invite you with me to offer a good morning to those who are joining us remotely. So here we go. 1, 2, 3. Good morning. Good morning. It is good to be gathered together. I wonder if you remember last week we talked a little bit about what we see up here, and we talked about the bread and the stone, which made us think about the story that we read from the Gospel of Matthew and Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. And you might not be able to see this very clearly, but I want you to know that back here in our might be Zoom, might be a meeting place tonight. There's a light here as we're thinking about the story that we'll read today from the Gospel of John in chapter 3, when Nicodemus and Jesus have this late night meeting. Now we'll talk a little bit more about that. Last week we talked about being hungry and the sound of our stomach growling. Today we're going to talk a little bit about gifts. Anybody ever receive a gift and never open it? Me neither. Usually if we receive a gift, we open it, right? And whatever it is, whether it's something to use or enjoy, that's what we do with it. But we're going to talk about the gift that God offers us in Jesus today, and how important it is that we receive that gift and respond to that gift. So we're going to talk a little bit about this special story that we have in the Bible. They're all special, but this one is really special because it gives us one of the most well-known verses that we hear all the time. Has anybody ever been in a football game or watch one on TV and you see somebody look in the end zone on the sign that says John 3:16? Anyone? Yeah. For those of you who memorize scripture, memorizing is always a good idea. It helps us remember things that are important. I don't do a great job of memorizing lots of things, but I learned John 3:16 pretty early on. Some of you might have too. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. And it sort of ended there. Now, there's a lot more in that story. We're going to talk about that today. But it's a gift that really talks about the gift that God gives us in Jesus. And that verse is really, really important because it reminds us that you've been given this gift of love in Jesus. So, it's one of the most famous verses that people, even when we hear it, sometimes even when people maybe aren't that familiar with Scripture, they say, oh, I think that's from the Bible. It might be John 3:16. That's something that might be familiar to people. So, usually when we receive an incredible gift, whether even if it's not incredible, if we see a gift with our name on it, we want to open it, right? I do. But even though I'm not very good at shopping for gifts when somebody gives me a gift, I love gifts. I mean, let me not love gifts. That's what I thought. So, it'd be strange if we received a gift and didn't open it, right? Usually when we receive a gift, we open it. And sometimes for the person who gave it to us, they might be there and they like to see us open it. So we like to see people open the gift that you give them. We like to see people respond. So that's the other thing about the gift that God gives us in Jesus. I think God smiles. I think God is blessed when we respond to that gift with praise and thanksgiving. That's one of the things that we do when we worship. So the other thing with this gift that God gives us from Jesus is that when we receive that gift, our lives are never the same. And that's what happens for Nicodemus, which we're going to talk about here in a little bit. His life is really never the same after he has this late night meeting with Jesus, because we see him a little later on in the scripture too, and we'll talk about what happens for him. So I want you to think about the gift that you have, the gift that you enjoy. Maybe there's something that you can enjoy or use, and what it means to receive that gift and use that gift. So just like there are special things that we have that we enjoy at our home, we can remember that God gives us Jesus. Jesus is the gift to us, the gift of love. And so how do we use that gift? How do we share that gift with other people and love Jesus too? And love others because Jesus loves us. That's what we're called to do every day. So we're gonna come to the table today and remember the gift of love that God gives us in Jesus. And even this small, simple gift that we share, when we share a piece of bread and some juice, is a reminder of how much God loves us. So I hope that all of us can take that gift and remember that it's a gift for us to share. So let's pray this morning. God, thank you for all the gifts that we receive. But thank you most of all that you love the world so much that you gave us the most incredible gift. Because of the gift of Jesus, the gift of love that we received in him, our lives are never the same. And help us to share that gift with the world that isn't the same either. That the world looks more like what you want it to be, that we live more like the people of how you want us to live. Loving each other, caring about each other, caring with each other. And helping each other. Be with us and guide us, we pray every day. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, and our friend. Amen. We're going to be blessed this morning to hear a bit of new music. And this is Gathered by the River. I'm going to go to the hospital. It's a blessing to gather together. I want to remind you that we have a time of Christian education for our children and youth between our worship services, and we have some special materials that we're inviting families to use during this season, focused on 40 days together. And if you want to use them with your family, you're invited to pick those up as well. I want to invite you to send your God moments and your prayer requests in to our office at lakeharborumc.org. For those who may not be familiar, we have a practice here at Lake Harbor of writing down those times and the history from God's grace has been particularly powerful for us. It's a wonderful form of witness and a good reminder to all of us to be engaged and being intentional and thinking about how God is at work in our lives. We have an active prayer chain that is functional lots by email, and a few of those who call each other on the phone as well. So if you have a prayer request and you want to send it in, please be assured that it is covered in prayer. For those of you who are here at Sanctuary, you can write those God moments and prayer requests down as well. If you're joining us online again, feel free to send those in. We have our March newsletter available online, and we have some printed copies if you want to take one today, along with devotionals for March, both printed. And again, we offer that online every day on our Facebook page. This week, I want to remind you of lots of opportunities to be engaged. We have Grief Care continuing on Monday nights at 6:30 in our fellowship hall. We have multiple opportunities for Bible study Tuesday morning and Tuesday evening and Saturday morning. And Saturday morning, there's also a women's prayer group this week that will meet at 9:30. We serve at Supper House on Tuesday afternoon. Our youth groups will meet on Wednesday night. Our social justice small group will gather on Thursday night. And a reminder, so that you're not late, if you are, you have a couple of opportunities to worship. Next Sunday, daylight savings time begins. So, spring forward and lose an hour. And then just a reminder for all those opportunities to be engaged in giving and serving others as well. We continue to collect Bastia Green Keys for Anti-Gay Ministries and for partnership with Temple United Methodist Church in serving Edgewood Elementary. On the list of our social justice issues each month, we have a focus for prayer and for awareness and for action. And so for March, our social justice issue is mental health. And so we'll be hearing more about that as the month goes on. But please continue to pray for everything that surrounds that issue in terms of access, in terms of support, in terms of need. Our noisy offering for the month will support Mission for Area People, Mathematical Fund, and the work they do to help those who need help with specific medical issues and medical appointments, medical procedures where they don't have coverage. And you can make those gifts anytime this month. And I also want to remind you, in March, as a part of our larger United Methodist Church, we acknowledge we celebrate Encore Sunday. Encore is United Methodist Committee on Relief. You may have heard about Encore before. Encore Sunday is one offering that we take each year so that Encore can do its work with giving 100% of any other offerings directly to the needs that are there. So keep that in mind. We celebrate that typically on March 19th, which again, you can make those gifts anytime and mark them for Encore Sunday. It's a blessing to be able to support the work that Encore does around the world. I want to offer thanks to those who helped to buy meals for Family Promise this week, for those who worked on that close deposit. Lots of opportunities to get to be served and lots of ways that you can do that in lots of ways during the week. So during our offering time, we'll be blessed to read and to share those set moments that we offered this past week. Again, I invite you to write yours down and send it in. And let's worship God during this time with our gifts. You can prepare your offering. If you're here in the sanctuary, you can use the offering plates. You can prepare your offering or give it online at our website, recoveryunc.org. Let's worship God with our gifts this morning.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Alleluia, alleluia. Praise God, the source of all our gifts. Praise Jesus Christ, the Son of Christ. Praise the Spirit, Holy Spirit.
Unwavering love. You hold nothing back in your love for us, how we marvel at that kind of love, and how we long to reflect a portion of that devotion back to you. As we dedicate our offerings to you, lead us away from our tendency to hold back and worry that there will not be enough. Help us to live as the people of love and abundance you have called us to be. In Christ's name, we pray. Amen. As you may be seated, can I invite us to hear an account of Jesus' meeting with Nicodemus again? You'll hear it read in parts. God, open our hearts to hearing, reading, hearing, and understanding and giving of the word. From God. And there was a person named Nicodemus sent from the Pharisees, who were religious leaders among the Jewish people. He came toward Jesus at night and said to him,
"Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who comes from God, because no one can do this for you in your name, for as God is with us."
Jesus answered and said to him,
"Truly, truly, I tell you, unless you are born anew, you cannot speak of the kingdom of God."
How can a person be born once old and enter into another womb a second time and be born?
Truly, truly, I tell you, unless you are born of water and the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. And just as Moses lifted on high the serpent in the desert, so also the Son of Humankind be lifted up, so that everyone believing in him should have eternal life.
This is how much God loved the world. God gave God's only begotten Son, so that everyone believing in him should not be destroyed, but should have eternal life.
For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but so the world might be saved through him.
The word of God is for the people of God. I'm going to invite you to remain seated, but we'll sing two verses of a hymn called "Walk, O God, Our Sons and Daughters."
Walk, O God, our sons and daughters, where your cleansing waters flow. Number them among your people, blessed Christ, blessed long ago. Leave them garments bright and sparkling, compass them with love and light. And anoint them, send your Spirit, Holy Dove, and heart's delight. Oh, how deep your holy wisdom, unimagined on your ways. Through your name be glory, honor, with our lives we worship praise. We, your people, stand before you, water washed and spirit poured. By your grace our lives we offer, recreate us, God transform.
God, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of our hearts be acceptable to your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Nicodemus is one of my favorite characters in the Gospel of John. And if you haven't looked in the Gospel of John or ever read it, the Gospel of John is different than the other three. The Gospel of John has lots of long conversations between Jesus and individuals, and this one is the first one. We'll be witnessing of the others during this season of Lent. But this one between Jesus and Nicodemus is one of the first ones in the Gospel. So it's my favorite because I love that Nicodemus asks questions. And I love that Jesus responds. Now, Nicodemus is someone who has everything going for him. He knows the law. We heard in the scripture reading that he's a Pharisee. He has a reputation. He has status within his community. He's probably advanced in leadership in the religious community. And yet, here he is coming to Jesus at night, asking questions. He asks for a theological discussion, and he gets it. He wants right answers and right doctrine. But Jesus surprises him. Nicodemus comes to Jesus under cover of darkness, and for Gospel writer John, that's symbolic. Nicodemus doesn't fully understand who Jesus is in this moment. Practically, he comes because he doesn't want the light to know that he's coming to talk to Jesus. And yet, there's some symbolism there. He doesn't fully understand who Jesus is. And Nicodemus really gets stuck when Jesus talks about being born again. And when a man converted to Jewish faith, it was called a rebirth. There was prayer and sacrifice and baptism. Jewish teaching had references to God creating new hearts and new spirits in people. But Nicodemus wasn't making the connections. And if you are a language person and you like to think about words in the original Greek, that word that we translate again, born again, anothen, also means from above, from top to bottom, from the beginning, from a long time, or all over again. In our time, being born again has taken on its own meaning as a conversion experience. At times, Christians can judge someone else's faith, valid or not, based solely conversion experience is that there was a right way that we have that relationship with God. Sometimes we've even questioned the practice of baptism, how we use the water. Is it by immersion or is it sprinkling? And you'll see sort of a funny, I'll let you take a minute to look at it. Now, I find this funny because I have friends, colleagues who are Baptists, and we talk about the different ways by which we celebrate baptism. Is it a dunk or is it a sprinkle? Those are the kinds of conversations pastors sometimes have. Now, it's funny, but it points to some real questions that have caused conflict over lots of years. How do we know that we're born again? What's the role of baptism in all this? Baptism is a sign of God's grace and new birth in Christ, but the water and words are the end. We invoke the Holy Spirit to bless the gift of water. We invite the Holy Spirit to work within us. And we almost make some of the language look like a code that needs to be broken in order for someone to experience God. And maybe you've been asked the question before I have, even by colleagues in ministry. Have you been born again? Have you ever been asked that question? Are you born again? Have you been born again? I don't get it. I get the question. But I also struggle because we can't reduce what Jesus says to one kind of experience. It's total transformation, something new that has never been before. It's a clean break and a fresh start with God. And Nicodemus can't get past the literal, because we hear this the question, to be physically born again. He can't get past what Jesus is talking about. Jesus means born again in a spiritual way. God takes over in us so that our lives are new creations. We can't think of our existence without God. There's real transformation inside of us, and it shows on the outside. So our stories of being born again, our stories of conversion, our stories of coming to Christ, probably vary. If we asked 5 different people, the story wouldn't be the same. So Some of us point to a time and place when we committed our lives to Christ. Some of us talk about God's grace leading and guiding us through life, but a series of moments when Jesus became more than just a person we read about in the Bible. Jesus became our Lord, our Savior, and our friend because we realized that we can't live this life without Him. I was having a conversation with someone I've known for a long time. In the midst of time when a person who I've known for a long time is asking new questions and thinking about faith in a different way. And for me, it's really sort of like this conversation that Jesus and Nicodemus are having. Those questions don't stop, and those conversations don't stop, and that conversion that we have, that transformation continues. We talked about that word sanctification last week. We are always growing in holiness of heart and life. As different as our experiences might be, God takes the initiative to love and save us. That's where it starts. Life in the Spirit isn't something we achieve on our own. God leads us to it. And being born again isn't just a personal thing. It's connected to what happened to Jesus on the cross for everyone. It's an invitation to be in relationship with God and to be connected to the world God loves. And to make any sense of it takes us into a realm of faith. We can't make sense of the Holy Spirit. We have to do away with logic. Because Jesus says in another part of this conversation in John 3, the Spirit is like the wind, it moves where it will. We see the results of it, but it can't be contained or controlled. God works. God is at work through the power of the Holy Spirit, but not always in the ways that we expect. I also love this encounter between Nicodemus and Jesus because it's not the end of the story. We meet Nicodemus here in John 3 in this long conversation that Jesus one of the most familiar Bible verses, John 3:16. But then Nicodemus shows up two more times, named specifically by Gospel writer John. In John chapter 7, he's in a gathering of religious leaders who are becoming increasingly upset with Jesus, and Nicodemus is the one who asks if the law allows them to arrest someone without first hearing them. He sort of asks them to put the brakes on it. It's almost as if he is trying to calm them down. So that's in John 7, and then most powerfully, I think, it happens in John chapter 19. Nicodemus shows up after Jesus is crucified. He joins with Joseph of Arimathea and brings what's needed to prepare Jesus' body for burial, a sizable offering of spices and balm to care for Jesus in death. And this time, it's not under cover of darkness, but in the light of day. There's something here about a transformation in Nicodemus' life. He's different. He understands Jesus differently. So I love Nicodemus because I think he mirrors and reflects a lot of what we experience in our own lives, that deepening relationship with Christ. And the questions and the wonderings that we still have, maybe, but that deepening relationship. In this series, as we're thinking about these specific scriptures, and as we're thinking about that alongside our baptismal vows, we are looking at the second part of those vows today. Last week, remember, we talked about renouncing and resisting and repenting. Today, we talk about accepting. And so, this is the part of the vow that we focus on this morning. Let's see it here. To accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves. This has always been the most powerful part of the vows for me, but it's challenging when we pay close attention. This requires something of us, something from us. Resistance is important, but notice that we don't do it wrong. God gives us freedom and power to resist evil, injustice, and oppression. That's the work of the Holy Spirit in us. Something happened in this conversation that started Nicodemus on the way to claiming faith in Jesus more deeply. We celebrate God's grace in baptism, but that's not the end. Accepting the freedom and power God gives us. Yes, absolutely. But the freedom and power to do what? To resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves. That's a heavy thing. It's a big deal. It's hard work. Daily work. What's the present evil, injustice, and oppression that you notice? How can we resist it? Practically, we can resist evil, injustice, and oppression with our voices, our balance, our hands, our feet, our prayers. We step out and away from every force that seeks to constrain love and justice in our own hearts. And that's really where it starts. It starts with us. We care about the struggle of poverty. We care about those who are trapped in modern-day slavery. We care about those who live in fear of abuse and terror and oppression. We care about those who struggle with addiction. We care about those who are treated unjustly. We speak and act with courage for the freedom and dignity of every human being and the good of God's creation. We pray for leaders in every area of life, for our loved ones, for those who seek to protect us. We pray for everyone. And we come together as the body of Christ, and we do so in love and hope, believing that even now God is building the kingdom of God. Now, I'll be honest. I watched a lot of people look at the rocks last week and say, well, I could take a couple of these. We probably all could take about a box of rocks if we were honest. But this one really has become powerful. Again, mine says apathy. This rock continues to be a challenge to give up and let go of apathy in order to follow Jesus more faithfully. Challenges me to consider where it is that I've been apathetic. And it's easy to let things go when they don't affect me, when they don't concern me. But that's not the call of Jesus. I'm called to care deeply about the world that God loves, the world that Christ came to save. And that means I have to go beyond what's comfortable. And I have to be honest about complacency and comfort. And remember that Jesus was always doing the work of resisting evil, injustice, and oppression. Jesus' message to Nicodemus is what is it God works in us, that we are born again in God's Spirit. When we open ourselves to God's love and allow it to transform us. Nicodemus can't possibly know the fullness of who God is, even if he knows the rules. And again, he's a faithful Jew, a faithful Pharisee. He knew the law. He knew the 613 rules that he was supposed to follow to be faithful. But he can't possibly know the fullness of God, even if he knows the rules. With all that he knows, there's more to a relationship with God, and maybe that's a message for us. Maybe sometimes we're a little too caught up in the rules, so much so that we forget about the Spirit. We need to be born again, and maybe even again, and again, and again, opening ourselves to the power of the Holy Spirit. Maybe we need to pay a little more attention to the relationship. And remember that the relationship is what matters. It's love that saves us. It's love that sustains us. It's love that matters. God's love for us and our loving response to that love for the world that God loves. It's love that sends us out into the world to work for the kingdom. So I hope that we think about Nicodemus after today and think about his questions and think about his transformation and think about what it means for us to walk that same journey because that's where we are. Maybe some of us have questions. Maybe some of us are wondering. Maybe some of us hear that call. Continue the relationship we have with Christ. Well, today we have an opportunity to share with each other, but be give them this sign of grace as we come to the table where Jesus is host. We come because we're invited. We come because God wants a relationship with us in his holy time to remember who we are, to remember how gracious God is, to let God transform our hearts and help us to serve Jesus in the world. So we're invited to come to the table of grace, to come to the table of love, to come to the table and meet Christ here. Friends, would you join me as we open our hearts, as we offer a prayer together this morning? Let us pray. Holy God, creator of all that is, donor of grace and giver of life, hear our prayer. There are chasms in our lives, deep valleys that separate us from one another and from you. We confess that we have allowed those risks to grow for fear of admitting our part in the separation, for fear of being rejected when we reach out. You call us to a reconciled life, to healed relationships, to a wholeness with each other and with you. Mend us, we pray, and make us new creations through the power and love of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Let's hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and proved God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. As we come to the table this morning, I would invite you to be ready to respond with responses that will be projected as part of the great Thanksgiving that we share. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. You lift them up to the Lord. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. He is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust of the earth, you formed to your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away, our love failed, your love remained steadfast. When rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. When your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and on your holy mountain, he heard your still small voice. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your Spirit led him into the wilderness where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. When he suffered and died on a cross for our sin, you raised him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering and death and resurrection, he gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water in the Spirit. Now, when we, your people, prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during the 40 days of Lent, we may be gifted in grace to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. It was a night when Jesus earnestly desired to meet and be with his friends, his disciples. It was on the night in which he gave love up for us that he took bread. He gave thanks to you, O God. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took a cup and he gave thanks to you, O God, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering to us as we proclaim the mystery. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and cup. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to invite those who will help serve to come forward and those who will also be available for prayer to come forward this morning. As they do, a couple of reminders. Again, you'll be invited to come forward as you feel led during our time of communion. I also want to ensure that you know that there will be water here, a reminder of God's grace and love in our lives. You'll be invited as you come to water. Remember your baptism. If you've been baptized, if you haven't been baptized, touch the water. Know that God's grace is active in your life. As you come, I want to invite you to hear these words from David. Be grateful when you touch the bread, and not lie uncared for and wanting. So often, bread is taken for granted. There is so much beauty in bread, beauty of sun and soil, beauty of honest toil. Winds and rain have caressed it. Christ often blessed. Be grateful when you touch the bread. And as we prepare to come, I want to remind you that this is an open table, that all who seek new life in Christ are welcome to come and receive. Again, if you want to receive at your seat, let one of our ushers know and we will come to you. But come and you feel led as the reason one verse comes home to the table of Christ.
The table of grace. Come to the table of grace. This is God's table. It's not yours or mine.
Mr. Harkin. Dear Jesus, thank you. you have set up with yourself, that we may receive your freedom and power to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in every form in which they present themselves. In the power of the Holy Spirit, make us compassionate and just, loving neighbors and enemies, and do love us. And you above all, help us to love you, as we pray the prayer that you teach us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As is we're sent out to stand, if you are able and will sing together, feel me free.
I forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name, I come to you to share His love as He told me to. He said, freely, freely, you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. All power is given in Jesus' name, in earth and heaven, in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name, I come to you to share His love as He told me to. He said, freely, freely, you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live.
Friends, go from here and know that call to accept the freedom and power that God gives us to resist evil, injustice, and oppression. Know it and live it that the world might